to the question of the relationship between Lalibela and Jerusalem. And I will try to answer this question, or I will ask new question. I'm sorry for that, but I think this is our task in a way. So, as François-Xavier already told you, but I will just make a reminder for you, there is a sort of inscription in the topography of Lalibela, of the topography of the Holy Land. As you can see, there is not only churches which are dedicated to the Holy Sepulchre or other places in the Holy Land, but there is also Mount Tabor or the River Jordan with a monolithic cross in the ridge of the River Jordan, commemorating the baptism of Christ. So this topography is very important in Lalibela, of course. So here, details that François-Xavier already showed you, so I'm going very fast. So one of the main, the major place and the more sacred place in Lalibela is this complex of Mount Sinai Church, Church of Golgotha, Tomb of Adam, and Trinity Chapel. And first of all, of course, this topography is reminding the topography of the Holy Sepulchre. But there is also inside the Church of Golgotha a copy of the tomb of Christ, Jesus Christ, which is on the picture. And as you may see, inside the church itself, King Lalibela is considered to be buried just close to this tomb. And in front of all this complex, there is what they call the Tomb of Adam, as in the Holy Sepulchre, you have the grave of, the cross of Jesus was supposed to be, to stand on the skeleton of Adam. So the tradition of the Holy Land is inscribed in a way in Lalibela too. So I will go fast on this because Claire will come back to this idea, and it's in a way very complex. Just to give you some information, pictures are not good at all. We know that for sure. That the problem is that it's completely dark inside and there is no way to have good light, so we are still working on this problematic, and it is one of the big problems for us to work there. So, what about King Lalibela and Jerusalem? If we read the life of King Lalibela, because Lalibela is recognized as a saint by the Ethiopian church, and is, as I told you, buried inside one of his churches, and now people are coming for pilgrimage to his grave every year. In his life, written not before the 15th century, there is an information concerning his pilgrimage to Jerusalem. So it could be a way to have information about the idea of Jerusalem at the time of Lalibela. But as you can see here, it's a very stereotype text. You just have information concerning the places where Jesus Christ went, and Lalibela is just going where Jesus Christ went and putting his feet in the marks of Jesus Christ. And if you read all the hagiographies of Ethiopian saints, in fact, you have exactly, but exactly the same text. So we can't say, according to this type of text, that you have testimonies of pilgrims, Ethiopian pilgrims, going in Jerusalem at the time of Lalibela, or having a very precise idea of what is the Holy Land, what is the Holy Sepulchre at this time. So, what happened? No, later. So, if we try to understand what was the habit of Ethiopian pilgrims during the Middle Ages, we have some information, some hints about their capacity to reach the Holy Land and to see the Holy Sepulchre. The very first information concerning Ethiopian pilgrims dates back from the end of the 13th century, It's an Ethiopian king who is sending a manuscript to the Ethiopian community, which is living in the Holy Sepulchre. So for sure, at the end of the 13th century, we had an Ethiopian community. But before, we don't have any idea about it. The other thing is that we know that a lot of pilgrims were going from Ethiopia to Holy Lands. We have many details concerning this information, not through hagiography, as I told you, but through other textual sources. But it seems that these pilgrims never came back to Ethiopia. And it is the reason why I will explain the hagiographies themselves don't speak about a real Jerusalem. It's only a sort of ideal Jerusalem, not a real Jerusalem. So it's really difficult to answer to the question, what did Ethiopian, from the Ethiopian kingdom in the 13th century, add in terms of image, ideas, concrete things concerning Jerusalem, Holy Land, Holy Sepulchre. Still, it's a big question. We are sure that in the beginning of the 15th century, because the life of King Lalibela is written at this period, it is sure that the topography of the Holy Land was already inscribed in Lalibela. As you can see in this citation of the life of Lalibela, when they explain what happened, how they excavated the churches according to the revelation Lalibela received from God before he became king, we learned that in the beginning of the 15th century, at the time of the redaction of the life of Lalibela, churches of the first group took the name they still have now. Lalibela was recognized as a saint, as I told you, and most probably this process of recognition of Lalibela as a saint occurred in the beginning of the 15th century, and the writing of his life is in the process of the recognition of his cult. This is one of the altars we can find in Lalibela. There are many, many altars dedicated by King Lalibela himself to the different churches of the site. So it is very important textual sources for us. And in this dedication, we don't find exactly the same names and souls which we have now for the site or which we have for the 15th century. And this altar is a little bit different from the other one because, as you can see, it's not Lalibela himself who dedicated this altar, as he is recognized as a saint, as well as his wife, in fact. So this altar is a step in the recognition of the cult of King Lalibela, and most probably was written later than the souls who are contemporary of the king himself. And the development of the cult of Lalibela is, the other kings of the 15th century used the cult of King Lalibela for themselves, for the recognition of the kingship in Ethiopia, all in all. So here we have in one manuscript of the Lalibela churches, in the Gospel, a land donation of one king, King Baada Mariam, King Lemnadengel, sorry, for the commemoration of King Lalibela in the beginning of the 16th century. When we go deeper, we can see that even in Fra Mauro's map, which was drawn in the mid-50s, there is Lalibela and the region of Lalibela, which is represented on the map because at this period, Lalibela was considered as a place, as a step in the itineraries of pilgrims going from the capital city of the king, which was then at Barara, up to Jerusalem. So, due to the recognition of the holiness of La Libella due to the policy of the kings of the 15th and 16th century to the, for the development of the cult of La Libella, La Libella itself, considered as a copy of Jerusalem, became one of the steps of the itineraries for the pilgrims, Ethiopian pilgrims, going to Jerusalem. But on the reverse, due to the recognition also of La Libella as a holy king, pilgrims from elsewhere, from foreign countries, came to La Libella. And we can see on the walls of the churches some ex voto, as we are used to see, of course, here in Jerusalem or in Egyptian monasteries and so on. And here you have ex voto, believe me, the pictures are not good, but we have ex voto in Arabic, in Gez, and some in Coptic, showing that there is not only Ethiopian pilgrims coming to La Libella, but also foreign pilgrims coming there. And in the beginning of the 16th century, we have another testimony from a chaplain, a Portuguese chaplain, who went to Ethiopia with a Portuguese embassy to visit the king of Ethiopia. And he spent, he went there for, I think, two times in La Libella, and he described the site. So for us, it's one of our major textual sources. And he's giving us a very good idea of the way the cult of King La Libella developed and began to be more and more important. So if we gather all the things, we know for sure that in the 15th, and since the 15th, in the 16th, and then up to now, the inscription of the Holy Land and the Holy Sepulchre in La Libella was a real thing. Before that, we still can have doubt, and we don't know exactly what happened. But if we have a look once again to this very sacred place in La Libella, with the Golgotha Church, the Trinity Chapel, and the Tomb of Adam, here you have a section of this place, and you can see that there is not only one level under the earth, but also, in fact, two levels. The upper level is above the Trinity Chapel, at the top of the Trinity Chapel. It's a place we call, which is now called the Lodge of La Libella. It's a sort of corridor just facing the Church of Mary, and without any very important function, it seems so, but we don't know, in fact. But as François-Xavier Fauvel or Romain Manson told you before, we can show that there are different faces in the excavation of the site. And not only faces of excavation, but also faces of collapse. There are for sure many places where the rock collapsed. And most probably in this area, on the top of the Trinity Chapel, and in the place which is between the Trinity Chapel and the Church of Mary, the rock collapsed. And we have some testimony of this collapse here, for example, where there is the rest of a pillar which is truncated. And there are other pillars in the courtyard with the same, which are truncated. So nobody makes pillars like that. Normally you make real pillar. So after this visit in Jerusalem and many thanks François for giving me this possibility and Jan, of course, for giving me this possibility to visit Jerusalem, with this idea in mind, I think we have to look once again to this area and to think about the first idea of the first excavators of the site, when they were Christian, I think so, to make a copy of something which was probably closer to the early sepulchre than it is now. But this is once again only a question, and I will finish with